Thank you for the Dublin Anarchist Bookfair number 4 for inviting me to come here. My whole time has been since the 24th of last month, and I'm going back on the 10th, and this time has just been wonderful for me. It's been like a 30-year dream to come here and to meet people, to learn about the struggles that I have been knowing about, but to meet actual people and people who could tell me the story and people who are continuing the story here of the revolutionary movements here in Ireland has been very important. I want to just start off by saying, as a lot of times I start off in the United States, I want to say power to the people. But I got to tell you, now when we say that in the United States, especially back in the day when someone said power to the people, you would respond, all power to the people. You know, and it's a really important connection. Power to the people, all power to the people. And all power don't mean power to the politicians, power to the brainiac political activists who got all the answers, to the preachers, to no one. It said to the people, to the people. So I'm going to start off by saying power to the people. I want one more time because that's got to have some, you know, we done had breakfast already. I know that we got our energies up, and it is my way of getting rid of my butterflies, and my butterflies is pretty much gone at this point. Power to the people.
Power to the people.
Right on. I'm going to try to use this time as best I can to share with you some of the things of my experience that I feel have allowed me to move on, and I always hope that is inspirational to others. There was something that we used to say, like when we would march in the Black Panther Party, and I don't know if I can get you to do this too, but I swear if I do, it'll be the last thing I ask you to do. All right. We would march. You got to imagine, this is the 60s, and the Panthers was a pretty, we said, you know, revolutionary, but we had style. You know? And so when we march down the street, I mean, when we march, people joke now about when they saw Obama walking with Bush in the White House, Obama had that little slick walk with him. Well, we would kind of walk like that down the streets when we marched, but we would say a little chant. And this is what I'm gonna want you to do. I'm gonna say, hold your head up high, Panthers marching by. We don't take no jive, got a loaded 45. And then I say, sound off, and you say, free the people. I'm gonna say it again, sound off, and you kind of raise it a little bit, free the people. And then I'm gonna say, break it on down. And you gotta start, free the people, free the people, free the people. And then one last one, free the people. And it's dark in here, but I wanna see the hands go up anyhow. All right, so. Hold your head up high, Panthers marching by. We don't take no jive, got a loaded 45. Sound off,
free the people.
Sound off,
free the people.
Break it on down, free the people, free the people, free the people, free the people. You gotta imagine, this is the 60s. The 60s. Here's these militant Black folks coming down the street with black beret, black leather jacket, and a lot of times without weapons, because that was just California when it was still illegal to have your weapons in public. But imagine that we was this generation that was so different from generations that preceded us, because we was like not only daring, but we were arrogant in a really good way, with a self-esteem that said, nothing is going to stop us now. We want the power to determine the destiny of the black community. That was point number one of the Black Panther Party platform and program. We felt that we had learned lessons from the struggles before us, you know, and we looked at it as a 400-year struggle. But different from other generations, we said we're not only fighting for our freedom, but we are willing to defend it. Now, we, you know, a lot of people focus on the guns, but I want you to just think about what it means to have beliefs that says you are somebody beautiful, wonderful, deserving of total freedom, and you are willing to fight for it. When one picked up that gun, it made all the readings that you had read so meaningful, so impactful on your life that you now said, I'm going to fight for it. I'm going to join with other folks, not only within my community, but communities all around the world, actually, and fight to stop these systems of oppression so people can be free. So even me as a 17-year-old, I mean, this was some heady stuff. It was intoxicating, you know, like drinking a Guinness, one after another. I ain't got to that yet, but I should confess that my comrades here are trying to get me to that point. But when we came out into our communities, we were new people. We had an ideology. A lot of our ideology was formed by socialist ideas, by socialist analysis. We were a mass movement that began to pinpoint not just a racist system, but a capitalist class system. It was not like those analyses had not been to the black community before, but the Black Panther Party made it mass. It made it popular, so that we knew that we were fighting not just folks in power because of the color of their skin, but folks in power because of their class positions in society.
Let's get into the inner workings and the meaning of this. Let's get into the inner workings and the meaning of a black revolution and why black people have a right to take what's theirs. You can read the platform and the program, and it's a basic program, and it simply says exactly what black people have been crying for 400 years. One, we want freedom. We want power to determine the destiny of our own black communities. Two, we want full employment for our people. Three, we want decent housing fit for shelter of human beings. Four, we want an end to the robbery of the black community by the white racist businessman. Five, we want decent education that teaches us about the true nature of this racist decadent system, and education that teaches us about our true history and our role in the society and the world today. Six, we want all black brothers to be exempt from military service. Seven, we want an immediate end to police brutality and murder of black people. Eight, we want all black brothers and sisters held in federal, county, state, city, jails, and prisons to be released because they have not had a fair trial. They've been tried. They've been tried by all white juries who have no understanding of the average regional man in the black community. Number nine, and this is where Brother Hugh is being caught. We just want the courts to make sure we have peers on the jury or people from the black community as defined by their jive constitution of the so-called United States. The 10 is a summary with a major political objective. And that is, we want land, we want bread, we want housing, we want clothing, we want education, we want justice, and we want peace. And the major political objectives, we want a black plebiscite, and the UN, the black colonial subjects will participate, dealing with, analyzing, projecting politically upon the racist atrocities that have been committed against black people in this nation.
And for those of us who was not really good students in high school, we were now learning some terms that was just unbelievable. I would never have thought I would learn what the means of production was, or what was the bourgeoisie, you know, or the proletariat, or this new term that they were calling us, the lumpin' proletariat, you know? But now, in studying these things, we're beginning to understand our situation so much more than generations did before. We knew much more clearly what we were up against, the United States of America, what we were up against with this empire that was based on capitalism, that had went overseas to like build up an imperialist octopus that was just sucking up peoples all around the world or supporting those kind of actions from other imperialist powers. But the local situation is what was always the most important thing. Because when one joined the Black Panther Party, you wasn't issued guns like we was hoping, you know, and you wasn't even issued the uniform, which we was hoping as well. Because a year before I joined, they had already made an order that Panthers couldn't wear the uniforms anymore because it made us sitting ducks for the police, you know. So now we didn't join for the uniforms anyhow, so hey, we're here. But it meant so much to take ideas, revolutionary ideas, and go into your community and begin to engage people in your community with these ideas. Socialism, even communism. Democracy in a different way. We talked about democratic centralism and all this other stuff. But mainly it was people getting around a lot of times in a circle, but allowing everybody to say something. And of course there was a hierarchy because anytime the leadership gave an order or a new directive, we had to implement it and we didn't have so much say so. But on that local level, we learned that we could really draw on each other because we believed in a thing called each one teach one. Whoever knew something, you teach the other ones who didn't know it. And it kept going around. People in the community, when we started implementing these programs, really, really at the beginning were very skeptical about us. I mean, you gotta imagine, you know, our rhetoric is militant. This is the Black Power era, you know. We get up, this is very unusual, get up in the white man's face and say, you're a pig. You know, whether that was your teacher, whether that was the police, whether that was the local politician.
No more pigs in our community, all the pigs. No more pigs in our community, all the pigs. No more pigs in our community, all the pigs. No more pigs in our community, all the pigs. No more pigs in our community, all the pigs. No more pigs in our community, all the pigs. No more pigs in our community, all the pigs.
Anybody who got labeled with pig was an enemy. You know, because we saw pig as that low-life creature that would just waddle in the mud. And that's how we learned to identify our enemies. But when people saw the programs, after a time, it's by individuals like me, burglars, pimps, drug addicts, people on public assistance, welfare, alcoholics, working these programs that's serving these kids, or work in the free health clinics where doctors and nurses are coming to provide services or free clothing programs for those who were in need, people began to look at us differently. They began to engage us in a very different way, from the skepticism to gradually a sort of intimacy. One by one, two by twos, the mothers would start coming in. The fathers may come in, but the brothers and sisters of ours or our friends would start coming in. And when they came in touch with this program and us talking a different language than just submit, you know, it was like transforming not only them, but it was deepening our own transformation. Whereas whatever we were before, they saw different individuals. But in seeing these different individuals, it began to create a feeling like, well, maybe we can possibly pull it together and change the world. Because before that, many of us had believed that we wasn't shit, you know, because we had accepted what the system had said about us, whether it was because we were black, whether it was because we were workers, whether it was because we just ain't have the power to be able to challenge them. That's what the powerful do. That's what the rich do. They degrade those who are beneath them, who they place beneath them to get them to accept. But we began to destroy that myth. We began to explode that. And in doing so, people began to believe in the possibilities of change. That was the 60s. The 60s was just that kind of period. Panthers with guns. J. Edgar Hoover said it wasn't the guns. We knew it wasn't the guns. I mean, imagine 35s, 45s, some shotguns. Maybe somebody may have brought an AK-47 back from Vietnam. But what, against the most powerful military force in the world? Nothing. J. Edgar Hoover said it was the programs that was the most dangerous thing about the Black Panther Party and therefore declared us public enemy number one. The programs was the work that we did. The programs were those things that it took ideology or our beliefs into practice. We would not have been able to do that if we just yacked, if we just talked, if we just debated. It was when we began to move them into the community and actually engage people. For me, it changed my life. It changed my life. It taught me that people could do whatever we got together and declared we wanted done. It put power to the people into a very believable frame, because we saw what people can do on a local level. My hometown, Plainfield, New Jersey, was like 45,000 people, just very racially divided. And from what we were able to do as basically high school students with a couple of older folks who were adults, was create a movement in my hometown where people began to look at us for help, for advice, for defense. But we got noticeable by someone else too, by the police and the FBI. And they figured out ways to shut us down. And I'm not gonna go into a lot of that, but people know the story of Mumia Abu-Jamal. Our story was very similar to his. Teenagers, you know, who are active. But even when I was a teenager, a cop got killed, and me and my best friend were the ones who they were trying to frame for the cop killing. And at the time, we were facing the death penalty. But we knew, even at 17-year-olds, that this is what happens when you step into the role of a revolutionary. There are going to be moves against you. This is what the system do. That is their job. We had read the newspapers. We had heard the speeches. We knew that they did it in the United States. We knew that they did it in other parts of the world. We knew that they did it here in Ireland and in Mexico, you know. We knew about the Cuban Revolution. We knew about the revolutions going on in Africa. We knew that in the course of all those struggles, there were casualties, that there were people imprisoned, that there were people hurt, not just physically, but just even spiritually, mentally, emotionally. We knew it. But we were inspired that in spite of all of that, we got to keep going, that there are people all over the world who are on this same course, and that somehow it's going to come together. Somehow. You don't have to have it all figured out, but somehow it's going to come together. We had a trial. Luckily, the jury was able to see that it was a frame-up, and we were acquitted. Back into the struggle. Eventually, I go into the underground of the Black Liberation Army. I am like 18, 19 years old. I haven't lived yet, but I still believe and this cause that we're fighting. We are still trying to keep the Panther programs together, which we call survival programs. At the same time, now it becomes urgent that we figure out ways to defend the Panther programs and the communities that we live in. So at some point, I am recruited into the ranks of the Black Liberation Army. I am like 19 years old. My girlfriend is pregnant, so there's a baby on the way. My whole thoughts is on, do I do this? I would love to be around for this child, but there's a revolution here. About a week later, I come back to the person who approached me and I said, listen, I want to join. And I joined mainly because I said, well, if I don't make it, we can still win, because that's what revolutionary believes. We believe at some point we're going to win. And that child will at least come into a free world. So I don't make it. Okay, that's the sacrifice that we make. So I'm on. I'm gone. The first objective is to get some political prisoners out of prison. You know, and it has to happen in one of the most massive structures in lower Manhattan, which is New York City, the Manhattan House of Detention, also called the Tombs. Everything that I learned in the Panther Party, I am bringing with me. And a big part of that is one Huey P. Newton's words, the spirit of the people is greater than man's technology. So here's the Tombs, this big, massive structure of concrete and steel, police all around. No one would think about trying to liberate any political prisoners out of there, much less going up there with some weapons. But we have been taught that we have to be daring, we have to be creative. Some would say a little crazy. And I would agree with that, because revolutionaries who change the world are a little crazy. You have to be able to step out of the box, you know, to be able to create change. On the day that we are visiting these political prisoners, we were taking them food every day in a bag, give it to the guard. Guard look at the food, pass it on to the prisoners. We was able to do that. Except on this one particular day, we don't have food in the bags. We don't pass the bag along. We open it, but we pull out the weapons, and we take the guards, and we handcuff them to the toilets in the bathroom. And I think that's an appropriate place for guards because of the role that they play. If they played a better role, maybe they'd have been treated a little bit better, you know. But, and then we proceed right onto the floor that we got to get these political prisoners off. But it's a metal wall. All of this we knew. Windows, telephones, you talk through the telephones, windows, and everything else is metal. We have to cut through the metal. I'm the one who's doing the cutting. I'm not supposed to be the one doing the cutting. Somebody's got to do it. The person who was supposed to do it, he couldn't do it at the last moment because he was notified too late. Somebody's got to do it. I give myself a crash course. I think I got it. Let's go. The attitude was that we have to try. We have to take risks. We'll do the best we can. We know it's dangerous. So as I cut, there's a, it's pretty much like this here, but we get about to this much to go and the oxygen tank runs out and can't cut anymore. We can't kick it. One of the sisters wanted to shoot it, but that would alert everybody, you know. So there was only one thing to do, which was to leave. But the part that was hard for me was just telling the comrades behind the wall there, we gotta go. And looking at two of the sisters in this unit, because it was their men also behind the walls. That was hard, because this revolution was also reconnecting families of revolutionaries. But one must move on. One must not stand around and get caught. One must get back to the movement, get back to their places of safety so that they can continue to struggle. And as easy as it was for us to get in and do all that, was easy as us to get out. To get out of there, and we're on to the next part. Months later, during the course of a bank expropriation, which I do not say bank robbery because bank robberies are wrong and revolutionaries do not do things that are wrong. There was a shootout. A couple of cops got shot up pretty bad. One got shot up pretty bad. Three of us was captured. We're given 45-year sentences. All from the very first moment we're captured, we tell the judge, first day, you don't even have a right to hold us or try us because we are soldiers of the Black Liberation Army. You have been oppressing us for 400 years. One of the reasons that I wanted to start off with the clip was because it combines two things. Matrix, which I like. And it goes into the history, the stories of our struggle. Stories which, if we don't understand, is at the root of many of these modern, postmodern struggles that we're into now. Sometimes we miss some of the most very important things. And for me, like even in the United States, it's like constantly reminding people that our struggles, not just of black people in the United States, but of all people, have to take into consideration how this United States empire got started. From that British colonial outpost to the most powerful empire ever today. If we are going to be free as a people and then as a world of people, as humanity, we have got to confront those stories of struggle that take us to the root of what all of this is about. You know, how did all of this come about that there's capitalism, that there's beliefs and hierarchy and all of these things, you know? So for me, all of these things I began to learn in the Panther Party, but then years later, and being able to look back, I began to see how much more complex it is. From the time spent in prison, that long stretch was like a little over 12 years. So a little over 12 years was like university time, because that's how we dealt with it. If we wasn't trying to get over the walls or dig under the walls or through the fences, it was about studying to understand the complexity of this struggle. So for me, it was like, it's not just about racism and class anymore. It's like understanding the role of psychology, understanding the role of culture, understanding how deeply ingrained sexism and homophobia, ageism, and all of those things are. Understanding how man or human beings have made themselves the center of the world to the point where it becomes all right for us to like destroy other living systems and living beings and just take the earth's resources and do as we please because we feel like we're just something superior. But that ability to challenge what I had kind of accepted as, well, the world is one way, came from lessons in the Black Panther Party because it constantly challenged things that I thought I understood and then to begin to realize, well, I'm kind of lacking here. This one is kind of hard to shake. I don't really understand why we're putting all this concern over equal relationships between the sexes. Sometimes you got to be jarred. Sometimes you got to be shaken a little bit to see that you need to challenge yourselves. You need to expose yourselves to some other readings, some other learnings, some other experiences to be able to see more, to be able to be able to understand more deeply some of these oppressions that we're in, and also to understand why we can create a world that is at the best of our humanity, our human potential. So all of this stuff that I am learning from the Black Panther Party is telling me that there are different ways to struggle. Some of the best learnings that I had begun to take on was when I began to read anarchism, feminism, and a critical theory, and that whole genre of anti-authoritarian readings, because they shook me. They jarred me in ways that I never thought I would have to relook the situation that I come out of and the ways that we had responded to that situation. So and even in learning, when I began to read all of this anarchist material and in prison, at first, I'm like, oh, that stuff is too idealist. It'll never work. Some of the things that drew me to it when it started talking about unions and how a lot of the unions in the United States was so conservative, always worked with the bosses. I'm like, whoa, that makes sense to me because I know that's what workers do in the United States, especially with the racism. You know, white workers continually betraying the cause of white and black workers together. Like, oh, that makes sense. But from there, it was understanding also that when one has hierarchy, when one has a leadership in this way, where all the brainiacs are up top, coming out with these brilliant theories and analysis and programs without our input, that things tended to go wrong. For us, on the bottom. So now, instead of just reading all the Marxist-Leninist material that just made Lenin and Marx and Trotsky and all of them such the great people, like, I began to see from the anarchist stuff, yeah, but people on the bottom, the workers, really was cut out of all of that. That was kind of hard for me to accept at first. Same thing with the Chinese Revolution. I mean, we all carried red books from the Black Panther Party, and I learned a lot from it. To this day, learned a lot from it. Learned a lot from Marxism, too, the dialectical method and all this stuff. But the concern went back to the people. Where were the people in all of this stuff, all these social transformation? Why did it always end up in the hands of a small group who spoke in the name of the people? So as a black activist, as a black revolutionary, one, I want to struggle amongst my folks that doesn't result in the same kind of arrangement. I want an alliance with other folks within the United States that doesn't create a socialist revolution, and you look up and it's all the brilliant white Marxist, Leninist, Maoist telling me what to do, or telling our community what to do. I wanted something that was bringing self-determination to each and every community. I wanted something that was going to bring self-determination for those workers in the workplaces without some representative, because that was telling me that this was really going to be power to the people, all power to the people. All of the learnings that I go towards, that's what I want it to help me to understand. So from all of those things, and then from the Zapatista revolution, I begin to see that an anarchist revolution is really possible. It's really a doable. And I did not believe that in the beginning because it just seemed idealistic. But then that was one of the strengths of anarchism to me, once I really began to understand it. It's idealism, what it said about the human ability to create out of nothing, which in the black community, we could even call that jazz improvisation, just create out of nothing, you know? Just from some things that don't seem to have a relationship, you can put it together, now you got a new sound or a new relationship amongst people, you know? So here we are today. All of these things that have happened, you know, like from the 60s, from the defeat of the 60s to the surprising resurgence of free struggles in different parts of the world, to the different thinkings that people are putting out now, you know, it is possible for us to figure out how to create free worlds. Again, like the Zapatistas say, a world where many worlds exist. It's possible to do it. And it's possible to do it in ways that we figure is the best ways for it to be done. Your struggle may not require a gun. I think mine will. You know, I just think that what I have learned means it will have to be done a lot better, a lot different. And especially one of the reasons why it was so important for me to come to Ireland, because I had read and studied so much of the Irish Republican movement from the 70s, that there was problems. There was problems. So in coming here, it's like I'd be able to ask questions about what went wrong. How did things get so out of control? Because I want to know for our struggle, if we should ever get to certain points, that we begin to experience similar difficulties and don't know how to get out of them. And I know in the 70s, in the Black Liberation Army, we were hoping the guerrilla warfare would help to build that struggle, to keep it going. But what would have happened if the gun had just begun to take over? What would have happened even with us if those of us involved in the underground had gotten to be so cold because of the actions we would feel like we had to carry out that we would be no different from the militarized forces that we were fighting against? Big questions will come in my mind because anarchism proposed that we think differently about a lot of things, you know. So because of that, I am at that place today where I don't think there's anything we can't figure out collectively. You know, I don't think there's anything that we can't, in our, from our local situations to international situations, as long as we can communicate and as long as we leave that space with an openness to difference, we can figure it. As long as we're being on point about certain behaviors or certain attitudes that have closed us down in certain ways in the past, like what has closed women down? What has closed queer folks down? What have closed down folks of different ethnic groups who may be immigrants into the country or in our situation who've been in the United States from almost the beginning but never seem to have been a feeling of safety where one's voice could be heard in the mix of decision making to the planning to the actions. The only groups that I have experienced any of that in is the anarchist groups, is the anti-authoritarian movements, which tells me again, there are ways that we can factor those kinds of new practices in that allow us to overcome historic difficulties. So we're here today. There's an economic crisis. We're figuring out how to utilize it. In the United States, there's a black president.
As long as it's pro-capitalist, pro-imperialist, well, it was quite all right.
Hey, I think I have not heard anybody in Ireland yet tell me, like, yo, we've won. You know, because we know it does not matter the color of that person's skin, especially when that person is pretty clear that they're an American, that they're going to carry out the American way and things that have always been done. Clear. But we know it has symbolic value for those of us like me in the United States who, for a black man to attain such a position, it means a lot. Yet, for folks like me who understand, we still have to be the truth tellers, not only in terms of Obama, but whether we're here, we still have to be the one to tell our communities, our neighborhoods, those in the workplace, hey, if the world is going to change, it really depends on us. No one above us can do that. We must turn towards each other. Salvation is in each other. Now, I use the word salvation because I come out of a Baptist church. But it's a good word, because it means if we're going to save, if anybody's going to save us, it's going to be us. If anybody's going to liberate us, we're going to be our own liberators. So in that, we got to, like, seize these moments. We said seize the time, seize the moments. We have to realize who we are, what we carry, what kind of perspective that do we have that offers so much to the world. This is our time, and I truly believe it. This is the time for anarchy that has never been before. It depends on us and what we want to do with it. It depends totally on us. We have a role to play. Our numbers is not as important as what we want to do and how we want to step out of our own boxes to do what we know is best. So my thing is, let's seize the time. Whether it is here, different circumstances, but whether it's in the United States, whether it's in England, wherever, we have got to seize the time in ways that bring people's lives to the forefront, where we can seize control of those lives and let the systems of oppression fall. Let them fall. My thing is, the empire has to come down. Has to come down. I think what I've learned is that it's not so much necessary that you physically bring it down as if there was one cartoon that was one of my favorite anarchist cartoons. It's like, we just need to organize like we're supposed to do, get people to take back their lives, and the system will kind of get lost in the shuffle. Let it go. Let it fall. from not having our energy in it anymore. Let us defend every gain we make, but let us definitely get this system out of our lives, because the best of our humanity has been repressed because of those systems of capitalism and imperialism and neoliberalism and all the other negative isms. We have to do it now. And I want to stop there. Power to the people.
I was just wondering what kind of programs you were putting in place in the 60s in the communities that the authorities were afraid of.
Right. Programs were so important. It started off with, actually, I don't know if people have seen the movie, but the movie is really good. If you see the movie Panther, it's really good. It actually starts off with a scene in there around a street light. No, in fact, the lack of a street light at a certain intersection in Oakland, California. And because there was no street light, there was nothing to regulate the cars, and people would be crossing the street and get hit by the cars. Sometimes they get killed. And the community had been demanding a street light, which the city government of Oakland would never respond to until the Panthers came. So you gotta imagine, here's the Panthers with guns, and in Oakland you can carry your guns in the open, right? Self-organization. Panthers from these very communities, you know, would just begin to regulate the traffic at this intersection. They would get in the street, same way as if the police was doing it, and just regulate the traffic. At first, people were skeptical. Who was these people? You know, guns, black rays, black leather jackets. But then it's the everyday process of seeing these people there and realizing that they're serving a purpose. It actually eventually forced the city government to put a street light there. I ain't saying it wasn't without a cost, even something as simple as that. But it was the Panther Party responding to the basic needs of the people.
As you know, we have initiated a free breakfast for school children. The reason behind this is because we understand that our children go hungry, because we understand that the pigs won't get up off their ass and give us no food, because we understand that there's oppressors. Black Panther Party says that we're going to serve these children. We're going to feed them every morning. They get a full meal, grits, bacon, toast, eggs, everything they need for the whole day. We need the people's support. We need your actions. We need your money. We need your donations. We need your time. The breakfast program is a program for the people and by the people. All the Black Panther Party has done was taking the basic needs of the people and putting them into practice. Because we are practitioners.
So you had programs like that. You had children going to school on an empty stomach. So Panthers would organize free breakfast programs so that those children could eat. You know, it would happen in churches, it would happen in community centers, and probably sometimes in people's houses. But it was the same thing. When they first started, people was like grudgingly supporting it. And then seeing that these individuals were serious and that the children was liking it, parents and others would start coming in and giving a hand. From that, it was pretty much cop watch. Huey Newton and Bobby Seale was in law school. They was thinking about being lawyers. So they was pretty smart about the law. So they decided that because you could carry guns and because you had a legal right to carry guns, and you had a legal right to observe the police, they had every Panther study the laws related to guns and observing the police, what the police could do and couldn't do. So you gotta imagine, police brutality has always been a big issue in black communities, black and Latino communities, poor communities, Native American communities. There's a scene in the movie where police is doing their regular. Here's a black man that they done pulled off into the alley, and they're getting ready to like rough him up. Except a carload of Panthers come right there, they park, and here's these Panthers, about five of them, getting out of the car with guns. And they march up in formation right up to the two police and demand that they stop. It's next to a nightclub or a liquor store, a place where people drink. So in the commotion, people in the liquor store come out, and they're observing these black men and women with guns standing off the police, but talking about the law and the right to defend themselves and the right to stop them from brutalizing us.
When we first started, we had a police alert patrol, and we would patrol the community. If we saw the police brutalizing anyone, we would put an end to this. Usually the police wouldn't brutalize anyone if we were on hand, because we were arrested the individual, we would follow him to the jail and bail the individual out, whether he was a Panther or not. And we would gain many recruits like this. So therefore the community started to say that, well, these people are really concerned about our welfare.
Even when the police would talk back to them, take your weapon, put them weapons, or give me them weapons, Huey P. Newton would say, no, you give me your weapon. The attitude was so important, the attitude. And when Huey jacked off around in his shotgun, it raised the tension, but it told the people on the side that they said it, I mean, this is how we talk, them niggas is crazy. But this is why I say you gotta be a little crazy, because if you stay the same way that we have been raised to be submissive, you never move. But after that successful standoff, and the police, like one of them had a little brain, so he said, well, listen, I think we don't have a win here. We better go. And when they went, Panthers was handing out Panther literature to all the people that was observing. The next day, the word has passed by mouth about what these Panthers did, and people wanted to come join. And as even the mass media kind of spread it, they may have put their own twist on it, but we know how to read things. When others was like, yo, they are serious about defending themselves, a lot of us like, that's what I want to do. So it was local programs that dealt with the needs of people that we were trying to respond to that worked for us so well. Irish Republican movement today, I can't. I came here with a reason. I mean, one of the reasons I came is because I wanted to talk with folks from the Irish Republican movement. It had been one of the movements I was closest to in prison was the movement in the Philippines and the Irish Republican movement. I read Trinity by Leon Uris. And when I learned that Iris was been fighting for 800 years, when we always talk about 400, I'm like, oh my God, I didn't realize people have been fighting that long. You know? So, but then also, this is the 70s. I go to prison in the 70s. You got the hunger strikers, the first wave. Then you had Bobby Sand and the others. And like we're doing solidarity, hunger strikes and other things in the prisons in the United States, you know, for them. But we understood later on too that there was splits here and there. People felt like there was need for other directions, you know, and sometimes those got kind of dangerous and people got killed. But I began to notice that in the 70s too, a lot of our movements suffered defeats, you know, and before those defeats, there were splits. And I want to understand, what is it that causes these splits, and is there anything that we can do to kind of not go through that, especially to the point where we begin to kill each other, because it happened in the Black Panther Party too. Much smaller scale, but it's from people believing that I gotta go in this direction because I don't agree with what those folks are saying, but the opportunities are lost in terms of like continuing to build this community base movement that could possibly move us to a victory. So I wanted to ask questions while I'm here, and I did have a chance to talk to different people, you know, like in Belfast and in Cork and other places like that. I wanted to understand, because a lot of times our difficulties come from our own internal stuff. Black Panther Party is so key about that. It's like, the FBI knew the personalities who were the leadership, Eldridge Cleaver, Bobby Seale, Huey Newton. They knew how to infiltrate, and one person who you think you can trust is talking shit about another leader, and then that leader's got somebody saying something about Huey Newton. Next thing you know, the jealousies and the egos, there's a split. Here I am, me and my comrades are like in the middle. The Panther 21 is expelled, Geronimo Pratt is expelled, people that we hold in high esteem from the Black Panther Party. We're like, we don't know what to do, you know? But it divided the movement. So it's like for me to understand, like coming here, it's like, What happened? How did we get to that? How did we get away from the community? How did the gun become so important? You know? And Huey's side of the Black Panther Party too, and I don't even think they're gonna debate me, but they got corrupt. Huey got corrupt. They got into drugs. They began in Oakland, California, to actually rival the drug dealers. You know, it broke people's hearts. It divided the movement. It set us back. So how do we avoid them things? And this, for me, is like, well, let me understand how some other folks dealt with those issues, or how their understanding of how they happened, why they happened, or how they could be prevented. You know. So I mean, I know here, coming here, like Irish republicanism is very diverse. It's not monolithic. But I know that people are still trying to figure out how to proceed forward. And I know the peace process is very controversial. And it makes me think, well, what if we ever got to a peace process? You know, how would that have went? Who would have been those individuals that I might have felt, well, listen, you seem to be selling out. You don't seem to be talking to us. You seem to be isolating this group. How did one keep the process collective and diverse so that we don't leave people out? If it takes longer, hey, but we know who our enemies are and what our enemies will do. How far will we go to sitting down with folks that we know that have for 800 years have pretty much fucked us over? So why should we expect anything different from them? So, I mean, it's basically all I can say about that, other than I want to see the movement in Ireland figure it out and continue to go forward. Because it's like, for me coming here and seeing this, and I mean it, this is a beautiful place. Every time it's like Puerto Rico when I went there, I'm like, boy, this place has got to come under the control of basically the workers, you know. Such a beautiful place, like Puerto Rico, the United States is over them. That island can sustain itself. This island can sustain itself. But most Puerto Rican people believe that it can't. But the independentistas are struggling. They're struggling every day to figure out ways to, like, bring that hope back into the Puerto Rican people. Like, yeah, Obama, yes, we can, you know? So the last thing is, like, there's no more Black Panther Party. This is why I always say, I'm a Panther. I'll be a Panther till the day I die, but there's no more Black Panther Party. There's not many groups from the 60s that exist today, except for maybe the Nation of Islam, you know, and others. There's no more Weather Underground, but there's a lot of young folks who do tremendous work, great work. And for me, it's to support them, to lend whatever I can to help them, whether it is my experiences, whatever wisdom I may have, and I'm hoping that my other comrades do the same thing. I think that once one reaches, I'm 55, you know, I don't think I'm through yet, but, you know, I just think that at a certain point, young folks got to take the lead, you know. Older folks, especially my peers in New York, we have a tendency to want to be the leaders again. And a lot of us, when we wasn't leaders back then, why are we trying to be leaders now? You know, and plus my thing anyhow is like, I ain't looking for that kind of leadership. We have to learn how to move forward on a more horizontal way that respects people and that brings in more creative ways to make decisions and to implement, you know, actions that bring power to our lives.
I always appreciate the clarity of thought coming out of military veterans and prison veterans. I'm 49 today. I'm from the Christian anarchist tradition of the 30s, the Catholic worker, and from the 60s, the Berrigans, draft board raid, plowshares. And like the Panthers, rooting our resistance in practical solidarity with the homeless, which informs the resistance, and the resistance informs that kind of solidarity. My concern about anarchism is that, for me, it's more a question than an answer, an orientation. It should be very pluralistic, people coming from all sorts of ethnicities and traditions to it, rather than a vacuum-packed answer to everything. My question is about your time in prison, in terms of prison organising and your work now. We have a prison here in this town that has 620 people in a space for 410. There's very little political activity around that.
And I mean, in the prisons, when I went to prison, it was still in like a revolutionary prisoners movement that came off from the work of people like George Jackson, Martin Sostry, who was like the first well-known black anarchist before Lorenzo. So when I went, there was still a lot of folks who was interested in the prisons, regular prisoners, and like revolutionary ideas. So it was easy to do study groups. It was easy to get your little conspiratorial groups going to figure out ways to get out, you know, or to like first person coming to the end of their time to kind of phase them into the movement once they got out. I went in 74 though. By the time I was heading out in the end of 85, that situation was changing rapidly. It no longer became that easy to organize. There was an influx of folks who were like the gangs, the drugs, all of that stuff. And also the prison strategy was pretty much the same as on the street, because the prisons is a microcosm of what's going on the street. They started allowing us to have Walkmans. They was moving towards having allowing us to have televisions in every cell. When you went to the prison store, there's all these things you can buy, you know, and it was clearly all to keep us occupied and busy, where folks would not be looking to be sitting in no revolutionary group studying, you know, revolutionary ideas or trying to reform their lives in any way, you know. But I got out at the end of 85 and went right off into political prisoner work. But it's an atmosphere that is so different. People on the street don't really know a lot about the Black Panther Party, especially the young folks. And I share this a lot. When I asked a high school student when I got out, what did he know about the Black Panther Party? He thought it was a martial arts group, you know. It told me a lot. You gotta really think about it when someone says that. And I gave it a lot of thought, and it was like, parents didn't tell it, neighbors, local schools didn't teach it. You don't expect the schools and the system to do your job, but you gotta ask yourself why. And when I thought about it, I was like, well, damn, I mean, the police, FBI terrorized our communities. I mean, they raided our houses. They tore up our houses. They tore up our neighborhoods, you know. They made it like you join that stuff there, or you get involved with that stuff, there are consequences. And like people was feeling it. So here goes a generation that doesn't know. To this day, there's certain Panther children, who we call Panther Cubs, who know very little about their parents. You know, because whoever didn't go, or whether it was the mother or whoever, the grandparents, they didn't want to share the story. But that's something that happens automatically in other cultures. Coming here, everybody know the story of Irish struggles. You know, when I go to Belfast, I'm meeting like, you know, children's parents and others, grandparents who were part of that, who know. You walk down that street where they do the political tour, Falls, and it's like, here's the murals. You don't have that where I come from. You don't have it. What you have now is like when your conquerors take over and they make sure that their culture is reinforced. So it makes sense that you got Jay-Z, 50 Cent, all the other commercials that want you to be so beautiful and slim and, you know, all the things that take your mind off of organizing and fighting for your freedom, you know. But we carry on the work, and it's really just been a few of us, you know. It's been a few of us trying to carry on the work of political prisoners, raising consciousness about political prisoners, but it is very small, and it has not been successful. Another reason for me when I come here is like I want to know, you know, how was those movements, how did they get to be so successful in certain like nationalist communities in Belfast or Derry, you know? And so I had a chance to talk with people. I need to know, like, how did you organize, you know? Because today people think it's just demos, rallies, marches, forums. And I go back to the Panther Party, it's community.
After they ran the farmer off the farm, the pigs went round and called a meeting in the barn. Hannibal spoke for several hours, but when he talked about his plans for power, that's when the conversation turned sour. He issued an official ordinance to say, if you're not a pig from this day forth, then you supporting it. That's when the horses went buck wild. One of them shouted out, you fraudulent pigs, we know your fucking style. Hannibal's face was flushed and pale, all the animals' eyes full of disgust and betrayal. He fell the same way Sam fell. They took his tongue out his mouth and cut his body up for sale, for real. You better listen while you can. It's a very thin line between animal and man. When Hannibal crossed the line, they all took a stand. What would you have done? Shook his hand.